Hello, folks, and welcome to Crank It Up Pop. I'm your host for today, Jared Running Jr., and we're talking about the album that, let's face it, you all expect, 1989, Taylor's Version. Of course, as many of you here with us know, this is a re-recording of her sixth album, 1989, from 2014, and with this release, Taylor officially has two things left to reclaim, her name and her reputation. So, let's get into it. We'll go over some of my initial notes here to start on my top five from the OG 16 and the Vault tracks ranked in a second. But first, I want to do a full layout of the track list. Just in case nobody knows, you know, something. You know, I know that most of you know the set list, or the track list, but if somebody for some reason doesn't know, if they're watching this video as like, I don't know, just to kind of get an idea of the album, I want to go through that because I just want to cover my bases. And first of all, kicking the album off is Welcome to New York. And you may say you are wearing a Phillies hat. Well, let's face it, Taylor Swift's a Phillies fan. But to appease all of you, I was going to wear a Mets hat. And then I said, fuck the Mets. I could not do it. I'm sorry. Then next up's, of course, Blank Space. Third, Style. Fourth, Out of the Woods. Fifth, All You Had to Do Was Stay. Sixth, Shake It Off. Seventh, I Wish You Would. Eight, Bad Blood. Nine, Wildest Dreams. 10, How You Get the Girl. 11, This Love. 12, I Know Places. 13, Clean. 14, Wonderland. 15, You Are in Love. 16, of course, New Romantics. And then we have the Vault tracks. 17, Slut. 18, Say Don't Go. 19, Now That We Don't Talk. 20, Suburban Legends. 21, Is It Over Now? And then two, I debated including. I ultimately decided to do it, but if you don't consider these 1989 TV tracks, I understand. I definitely get where you can come from on that. But I ultimately did decide to include them. Of course, Sweeter Than Fiction off of the Target exclusive Tangerine vinyl. Of course, that has that bonus track there, and that was Sweeter Than Fiction. Obviously, previously released Taylor track. So if you guys have kind of some seniority in the fan base, you have definitely heard of that track. And then 23, she released this on the 1989 TV Deluxe Edition, but also a previously released song, getting its Taylor's Version. Bad Blood featuring Kendrick Lamar. And those two, I mean, weren't on the initial release that went out at 11 Central Time, you know, 12 Eastern Time, you know, however you want to look at it. So I can definitely see how you wouldn't consider those, but I'm going to count them strictly for me personally because I have listened to Sweeter Than Fiction, Taylor's Version, off the Target vinyl because I did go pick it up. My receipt is right here. And yeah, the Bad Blood featuring Kendrick Lamar. I'm just going to count that because I guess it counts. It was released, you know, before this video. So, you know, screw it. Hey, let's throw it on there. Let's throw it on the track list. So the first thing I want to do here is kind of talk about the history of this album. Because, of course, as we said, it's from 2014. It's, of course, not a fully new album. It's not like Midnights or For a Point, Guts from Olivia Rodrigo, the last episode of Crank It Up. This is a special edition, if you guys don't know. It's not the, like season two or anything. It's just a special edition because it's Taylor Swift. But this isn't a new album. I have previously ranked this album. I have previously looked at this album for other projects outside of Crank It Up, before Crank It Up even existed. A little under a year ago, last December, I ranked this album. And when I went through and, you know, I looked at the rankings, I thought it was kind of interesting. I do want to go over that, and I'm going to throw it up here either on, you know, this side or this side of me. I'm not quite sure. Just so you guys can see it. But Keeley, I want to point out my top five was Wildest Dreams, Bad Blood, Style, How You Get the Girl, and New Romantics. And I kind of want to look at that before, because you guys are going to notice something, and that's really that there's some songs I've moved around, and I'm, you know, I'm going to hit this point a few times, and I know. But you guys understand, taste has changed in a year. Things have changed since I ranked it last, and things might change a year from now, and things might change 6 months from now. You know, that's just how music is. It's what you're feeling in the moment, and I'm going with what I felt in the moment, you know, for the last little bit here when it comes to 1989. And yeah, my top five right now, what I would have to say, like, if I'm taking my top five songs off the album, this is just what I have going for me right now. And that's, you know, all I can say. Number one, I'm gonna go 1 to 5, and I'm gonna do the same thing with the vault tracks. I was thinking about 5 to 1, but I'm gonna hit you guys with the big hitters right away. Screw it. Number one is I Know Places. And this one is one that going in did not surprise me. I Know Places has easily been my favorite 1989 song lately, and it had no question in my mind that it would be my top song with TV. It's an underrated song, I think. I don't feel like I hear it held in this air enough where people are like, this is my favorite. Hell, the fact that I had it at 9 a year ago, I think, is questionable. But like I said, tastes change. And in this case, I think it was fully for the better. I think I Know Places getting a lot of love on my list, and I love that. And you know, if you guys are like, not my thing, that's okay. That's okay. Because I think I have 4 other songs that you guys might be like, yeah, that's my taste. Actually, 5 other songs, kind of spoiling something there. But number 2, wasn't even a question for me to be on the list. I mean, this was my 5 back then for a reason. It's New Romantics. It's a goddamn certified bop. I don't think that I've met anyone who doesn't like New Romantics. It's just a song that puts you in the right headspace, puts you in the right vibes. It just does everything right. It is like the perfect song sound-wise. It's just, it is such a fantastic track. And the way it like makes you feel, the way that it, you know, it just, it puts you in that right headspace, those right vibes. It's just, it's not my favorite for me, but it is one of the best songs. And that is something that I think people need to understand. There is a difference between favorite and best. I think it is one of the best songs on this album. And I think there's a lot of really good songs, damn good songs on this album. And I'm going to talk about a few more of them. Number 3, I got Bad Blood. I mean, this is obvious. Bad Blood is him, as the kids would say. It's a Hall of Fame track. It's one of those that is up there when it comes to 1989 with the likes of Welcome to New York, with Blank Space, with Shake It Off, and with the previously mentioned New Romantics. I also have one more track on this list that is just slightly behind it, for no good reason, but I had to rank them. I had to give each song its individual spot. And that's number 4, Style. If Bad Blood is in the Hall of Fame, then Style is right there with it. Style is the franchise great, the legend of the game, number in the rafters in the Taylor Swift lore. Really, It's maybe one of the fans' favorite songs. You know, The Outsiders, they love Shake It Off, and that's all right. There's nothing wrong with that. The Outsiders can love the song they want to love. But the Swifties, they're obsessed with Style. There's some reason behind it. And, you know, I don't blame them. It's the one song that scared me. It may lose its feel coming in here to the TV. There's just things about it that I was like, this has got to be present. And in no way did it lose its feel. It is the same song. I was vibing from the Taylor, What Time Is It, to the first James Dean, Daydream, Look in Your Eye, to the Tight Little Skirt. And you know what I mean by that. You know, there's the part where I'm not going to try and do a Taylor thing here, but where, you know, where she says Tight Little Skirt and it just has that sound to it. And it's those little things we look for on the re-recording. That is that there? Is it present? Does it hit the same or does it hit different? And I just feel like listening to Style here, and the Taylor's version of it is just so close to the original. And I think that that is what we want to look for, obviously. And I think Style does a damn good job of it. It is, in my mind, a certified vibe creator. It is, in my mind, that song that we will always love for what it is. Number five. I'm going to cheat here a bit. I'm going to cheat here, guys. Bear with me. I got How You Get the Girl, and I got Out of the Woods. I know. I'll give you what I decided on as number five. But this is a tough choice for which one I go with. Out of the Woods is that song that, in the fan base, it seems everybody loves it. It has so many memorable moments. You know, from Taylor as an artist, it just makes it so distinct. And the fan base knows it so well. If that makes sense. And you guys know what I'm talking about. There's just the quotable lines in it that the fan base talks about. It's a song that I feel like I hear people on Twitter and, you know, on TikTok and all that social media jazz they're talking about constantly. I don't know why I said social media jazz, but you know what I mean. It's a song that is constantly in the talk for the fan base. And many of you are members of the fan base, I assume, and know exactly what I mean when I say that. But on the flip side, How You Get the Girl, it's memorable in its own way. It's amazing in its own way. It's poppy chorus. It's distinct beat. For the integrity of making a call on what is really five, I will give you something. But no, for my personal ranking, these two are a tie. I don't want to have to make a call on which falls out of the top five. But I'm going to do that. For my official call, I'd have to go with Out of the Woods. As I said it, it's iconic. And it's just too iconic not to have a spot in my top five. And yeah, I'm going to have to give five to it. And that's not saying anything bad about How You Get the Girl. As we establish, that is a song that a year ago would be in my top five easily. But things have changed. There's movement on this list. And really, I had to make a call here. And I gave Out of the Woods its spot in the spotlight, I guess. Even though it doesn't need it, as I said. It's memorable. It's iconic. Now, do you guys mind if we talk the vault tracks? Of course not. All right. This is one that I'm going to be real going into. Tough to rank. I really, coming into this, had no idea what I thought of the vault tracks, what I wanted to say. It's a tough game with the vault tracks that they either click immediately. And I'm not saying this in a bad way, but I mean, this is just something where the game of it is they have to work and work with you for you to have something to say. And I'm not saying, like, I dislike them. I like them very much, and we will get to that. But I, on first listen, was just, what do I think of these? I like them, but what are my thoughts? I just could not put it into words. I could not write down, like, this is what I think. And it was a tough part, and I've had to listen to them at least 3, 4, 5 times until I could really get a grasp on how I wanted to put it, how I wanted to put my thoughts on each in each song into words. And really, I'm going to give it my best go here, and you guys might say, well, what you said is really weak, and that's fine, but this is what came out. This is what I could piece together on such short, having to try and force something out because of this review going out on a Saturday and the album basically just being out. Me really only getting less than 24 hours with it before I have to try and piece it all together. And I hope you guys understand where I'm coming from there. Number one is Suburban Legends. And I thought this would be my number one. I thought another song would be my number one. But in the hours leading up and in the day of the drop, I kind of started to say, I think it's going to be Suburban Legends. Like, I kind of think it might pull it off. And it did. It did. It's easily my favorite Vault track. It works in every aspect for me, and I think it forms such a strong track. And it's tough because there is four other very strong Vault tracks here, and I think that it is a shame that they kind of have to take a backseat for me to Suburban Legends because, as you're going to hear, I do have high feelings, strong feelings about all of the other Vault tracks, and I don't really feel like my rankings do justification to this because it's kind of hard to say, you know, well, why is this one? Why is this two? Why is this three, four, you know, so on, because they're all so strong. And every track I describe, I'm going to describe it as the strong, beautiful, strong track it is because that's what they all are. Number two, Is It Over Now? As I've seen many put this, I thought Mother and Father had an amicable breakup, but I think we can officially say that Harry Styles wasn't safe from the re-recordings. But forget about that, seriously, because this is a damn good song. I don't give two shits if it's about Harry Styles. I know that we're going to get caught up on that, but who cares? This is what I would call the best song, and as I said before, the best song, my favorite song, different. This is what I would say is the best from a quality perspective out of the vault. This is what we call a literal work of art. It just does everything to perfection. A perfect closer, if not for Sweeter Than Fiction and Bad Blood with Kendrick existing. But we can ignore those because they aren't bass album. Is It Over Now just closes the album on the right way, and I think if an album has a strong closer, it does a lot for the album, and I think this was the perfect choice. Obviously, Taylor did it because of the whole kind of joke of, is it over now? Is the album over? Obviously, but it was a good choice. It was a good choice regardless. They are just strong Vault tracks, and it happened. She probably put the best one last from a quality perspective. And then that's where we move on to number three. This one, I'm going to kind of keep a little short, but obviously love it. And that's Slut. It's not what I expected, but it's a very good track. It's the perfect start to the Vault, I suppose, is the best way to put it. It presents the dilemma that plagued me throughout, as I kind of told you guys, of not knowing what to say, what to feel, what to think. How do I approach these Vault tracks for a review? And, you know, all I can say about this song is that it's not that poppy dance track that many expected. And, you know, it's probably better for that. It takes it slow. It takes it, you know, cool, calm, collected. I don't want to say cool, calm, collected. You know what I mean. It's not upbeat. It's not a punch in the face. It's, you know, not a poppy dance mix. And it didn't have to be. Really, it didn't have to be. And that's good for it. I think the fact that it really went against all the expectations of the fan base coming in and still produced an amazing track says a lot. And also a cool little note that likely all of you have heard already, but Slut is officially a single, and I love that choice. I think it's an amazing choice for the first single off this TV version. You know, if I'm sitting here going, do I think it's a better single choice than I Can See You? Yeah. Yeah. But I really think any of these would have been. And that's nothing against I Can See You. It's strong vault. Number four, Say Don't Go. I've seen a lot of people say this was their favorite in the aftermath. I've seen it change a little bit. I've seen a lot more of Is It Over Now? And Now That We Don't Talk, which we'll get to. I'm kind of happy about that. Because I don't overly disagree with people that think it's their favorite. Obviously, entitled to your own opinion. Go for it. But it's not my favorite. And I would never say it's my top track. But, you know, if it's your personal cup of tea, go for it. Roll with it. All good. Don't blame you. Very good track. But not my favorite vault track by a country mile. Number five. Even this one, maybe could have moved it up to four. Maybe put Say Don't Go at number five as the least favorite. But that's up to you. Really, I would really say I don't care how these two are ranked. I think the other three, I got them in the order I put them in. And these two, yeah, I mean, probably going to change this opinion a lot. And that's something that happens a lot with the vault tracks. I think one's the best, and then I'm like, oh, but then this one. And it happens. You know, what's the worst right now might not be my worst in 2 months or a week or, you know, any time frame you ask me, I might say something different. And Now That We Don't Talk, I think, is the song that has the maximalist pop vibes that are so closely related to 1989. Hell, I may say this is the most 1989 feeling song from the vault. I love everything about it. I love the beat. I love how Taylor sounds. It works nearly to perfection on a strong vault. It's a song that pulls out the pop vibes in a great way, and I think there's other songs that do it amazingly. I think Is It Over Now? I think Suburban Legends. But ultimately, those just got a little bit of an edge over Now That We Don't Talk. And, you know, maybe I'm convincing myself right now that it's number four, but I'm just going to throw my hands up and give you my vault feelings overall. Because overall, as you can kind of tell by what I'm saying, I think it's a very strong vault. I think that throughout, there is some very good tracks here. And I think that was to be expected with 1989. We know a lot of what Taylor left on the cutting room floor there with this album because she had so many songs for it. And I think that we knew that there was going to be some really good vault tracks that she was able to include on the Taylor's version. Production. Of course, this is the question on everybody's mind with the re-recordings. Will the production hold up? Will it sound the same? Will it be able to capture the magic that I remember? Well, you know, this never worried me. I have most of the crew back, really, sans Max Martin. Gave me tons of hope. Of course, I'm talking Jack Antonoff and Taylor herself, but also the return of people like Ryan Tedder of One Republic and Shellback, who did work on the original. Now alongside new collaborators like Christopher Rowe, who you probably heard that name. He's been a part of every re-recording thus far. Really simply, is there a different sound? Yes. Is it a bad thing? No. Obviously, the goal should be to get it to sound the same. And, you know, it's not different because I don't think that Tedder or Shellback or or Rowe or Antonoff or Swift or any of the other names and the many names that were a part of this, and in pretty much every case except Rowe, a member of the original. I don't think it's on them. I don't think that they didn't do their job. What I think's different, and I think that people want to ignore this, and yeah, it's great, but it isn't true. You can't ignore it. Taylor's growing. Taylor's matured as an artist. Taylor is a different artist than she was 9 years ago. And that, of course, includes her voice. It's going to sound different. Taylor is going to sound like a more mature artist that knows how to use her voice in different ways, how to change her sound, to perfect her sound. And I know you guys want her to sound the same, but all she's doing by changing these things, by using the aspects that she's learned as an artist, as a singer, throughout her career, is giving us better songs and improving on what we thought was perfect. Maybe style doesn't sound the exact same as how you remember it back in 2014. Okay? That's fair. But it's still the same song we fell in love with back in 14. As Andrew, fellow co-host here of Crank It Up Pop, put it, it's more heavenly. Is New Romantics different? Sure. It was the first thing I noticed when it came on. But it was my favorite song a year ago for a reason, and it stayed in my top two now for that same reason. It's still an euphoric feeling when you hear that song. I guess what I'm saying, folks, is the production may differ in small ways. Taylor may sound different. We're going to inevitably notice these things as fans who've listened to these records front to back over and over and over again. Yes. I understand that may be a hard pill to swallow, but ultimately, it's worth it for what these records mean, not just for Taylor, but for music as a whole. The ability of Taylor to be able to set out on a goal like this, to re-record her records and make them mean something, as she said throughout the Eras tour, she did not expect us to care as fans. They meant something to her, that she was doing it for her. But she didn't expect us as fans to care, to give up on those stolen records, to throw them away, and to embrace what she was doing. And it's fine if you can't. I understand that. I understand that you want the records that you remember. You want that same sound that you heard in 2014 when you maybe fell in love with Taylor Swift for the first time. And that's okay. That's okay. You can continue to listen to the stolen version, and I'm not going to judge you. I'm not. I can gladly give those away. And I'm not doing some all righteous thing here. I genuinely mean that. I do you. Do you. But I think it says a lot about the Swifties as a fan base, the ability to say goodbye to those albums that got people through tough times, you know, were the moment when they fell in love with an artist that has meant so much to them. And it's beautiful that so often when these albums come out, you have people saying, you know, it's just the opportunity to fall back in love with this album. And I think it's beautiful that is the story of these albums and the re-recording journey and the fact that we had two more stops on it, and then Taylor owns all 10 of her records. And, you know, maybe the day will come when she owns the stolen version again. And that will be a great day if it does come true. If it doesn't come true, we will always have the Taylor's versions to remind us and to be there as a, you know, holder of the past of 2006 when it all started, you know, to the Fearless, to the Speak Now, to the Red, to 1989, to Reputation, you know, it's something, and it, you know, it's, guys, when it's done, it's gonna be, an interesting road forward, and I don't know what that road holds. The only person that knows is Taylor, and we'll follow that road wherever it takes us. But just, you know, when these re-recordings come out, it's just reflect on it, you know? So often we as a fan base, and, you know, there's nothing wrong with this, but we as a fan base want to move forward. We want to talk about what's next. And is it probably reputation? Sure. Sure. But we're always, and there's nothing wrong with this, you know, but we are moving forward so fast always. And, you know, I don't feel like we ever really take the proper time to reflect on and what's in the present. Because likely this is hopefully the last time we'll ever have to talk about 1989, and it will be, because it's hers now. And that's the fun of it. And, you know, and yeah, I mean, guys, she's had a damn good career, almost 20 years, and here we are. My overall evaluation of the album, of course, obviously, I love this album. I mean, I just, like all of you, love the Stolten version. And now we get 5 amazing vault tracks. We get Sweeter Than Fiction TV. And if you picked up the Target exclusive vinyl, and, you know, really, it's one of the best albums. One of my favorites of her, maybe not. Not in terms of if I'm picking 5 albums, I'm going to a deserted island. I'm going to have 5 records I can listen to my time there. And the rest cease to exist in my world. I'm not going to pick it. But is it one of the best, probably top 5 in Taylor's discography? Yes, it's a very, very good album. And I know for a lot of people, it probably is in your top 5. It might be your favorite, and it might mean the world to you. And I'm happy for you. You get to relive this album. You know, I know how it felt for me to relive Red. I know how I feel thinking about Reputation coming out again. So have fun. Have fun, I guess is what I'm saying. And I'm going to have fun with this album myself. I've been Jared. And had fun with the special edition. Special edition of Crank It Up Pop. I'll see you guys in the next episode. Do I do the thing?